Epidural anesthesia is a type of central neuraxial block where we inject local anesthetic drugs with or without some adjuvant analgesic drugs through the epidural catheter or the two-way needle into the epidural space to provide analgesia for post-surgical patients, for labor patients, and even for anesthesia for surgical procedures. Pre-packed sterile epidural sets are available in 16, 18, and 19 gauge of the two-way needles with the respective size catheters. The 2E needle is an 8 cm hollow metallic needle with a stylet, the distal end of which is sharp and curved to facilitate smooth passage of the catheter. It has 1 cm markings on it starting from 3 cm from the tip. The epidural catheter is a long thin plastic tubing with markings starting 5 cm from the tip and markings at each centimeter length up to 20 cm. The tip of the catheter is blunt and firm. The catheter should be flushed with saline to confirm its patency before insertion. The catheter has 3 holes distally facing in 3 different directions, and as we inject the saline, we can see the saline pouring out through all the 3 different holes. Distally, the catheter is connected to a yellow colored connector. An epidural filter device is also available in the set, which prevents transmission of the particulate matter or infection into the epidural space, and that should also be flushed with saline. The loss of resistance syringe is a 10 ml low friction plastic syringe specifically designed to facilitate successful location of the epidural space. The procedure should be done using all aseptic precautions. The patient is preoperatively assessed and consented about the epidural. Minimal monitoring standards and a running IV access is essential. Most people would prefer sitting position as in this video. However, others may prefer lateral position, especially in thoracic epidural and in children where we do it under general anesthesia. In sitting position, ask the patient to curve the back and push it backwards, relax the shoulders and look downwards with chin to chest. This helps in widening the intervertebral spaces. Clean the back with antiseptic solution, either betadine or chlorhexidine as per the institutional policy. Drape the lower back with sterile drapes. Palpate the vertebral dorsal spines to identify the midline. The lower level of the scapula corresponds to T7 thoracic vertebrae, the 12th rib to L2, and the post-iliac crest, which is the toughest line, corresponds to L4. We decide the level at which we need to introduce the epidural catheter depending upon the dermatome that needs analgesia or anesthesia and the extent of the surgical dissection. In this video, I am aiming at T8-9 level. Infiltrate about 4 to 5 ml of 2% dignocaine at skin and subcutaneous tissue using a hypodermic needle to maximize patient comfort. This needle will also help us to identify the right direction and depth to the epidural space. In the lumbar level, as the spinous processes are short and stout and straight, you can introduce the 2E needle in midline perpendicular to the skin. But in thoracic vertebrae, the spinous processes are angulated downwards. So here we have to introduce the 2E needle in the midline at an angle of 35 to 45 degree cephalate. Feel the upper border of lower vertebrae and just about it introduce the 16 gauge 2E needle in the midline into the skin and the subcutaneous tissue. As the 2E needle is advanced further, it pierces the supraspinous and interspinous ligament. Remove the stylet from the needle. It prevents the needle tip from getting blocked by the tissues. Now, attach the loss of resistance syringe with not more than 3 to 5 ml of either air or saline. Advance the entire assembly of the 2E needle and the loss of resistance syringe into the back not more than 2 to 3 mm at a time. Each time, check for resistance by gently pushing the plunger in the syringe. It should bounce back because of resistance of the tissues. Keep the needle very steady and ask the patient to be very still. As the needle tip pierces the ligamentum flavor, which is a tough ligament, the resistance increases. And as the needle tip goes beyond the ligamentum flavor, you can feel a pop and there is a smooth collapse of the plunger into the syringe, also known as loss of resistance. If you are using a saline-filled syringe, the saline gets sucked into the epidural space, as the epidural space is a potential space with pressure lower as compared to the surrounding tissues. Now attach a 2 ml saline filled syringe into the 2E needle and inject 1 ml of saline into the epidural space. Free and smooth injection of normal saline confirm the needle tip to be in epidural space and also pushes the dura away and prevents inadvertent dural puncture by the catheter tip. Now connect the introducer to the 2E's and introduce the epidural catheter very gently through the 2E's needle into the epidural space. Note the markings on the 2E's needle to note the depth at which the epidural space was reached. Introduce the catheter at least 5 to 6 cm beyond the depth at which we reached the epidural space. Avoid withdrawing the catheter with the needle in the back as it may shear the catheter. Gradually withdraw the 2E's needle over the catheter without dislodging the catheter from the epidural space. Now attach the distal end of the catheter to the yellow connector and aspirate to check for any blood and CSF in the catheter. This is to rule out the tip of the catheter in interdural or intravascular compartment. Inject about 1 ml of normal saline and confirm the free injection without any resistance. Now disconnect the catheter from the connector and check for fall in the saline column in the catheter as you raise the catheter higher. This confirms right placement of catheter in the epidural space, also called as a meniscus sign. Some people may inject adrenalized lignocaine and look for symptoms of sensory motor changes in the legs for interdural placement and hemodynamic changes for intravascular placement of the catheter. Now, withdraw the catheter gently so that 5 to 6 cm of catheter is in the epidural space beyond the depth at which we reach the epidural space through the 2E's needle. Once again, aspirate and confirm negative aspiration for blood and CSF and flush the catheter with 1 ml of saline. Once the epidural catheter placement is final, reconnect the yellow connector at the distal end. Connect the epidural filter distal to the yellow connector. In children, the epidural catheter may be tunneled into the subcutaneous tissue to prevent accidental dislodgement or migration. Now, we fix the catheter at the back by making a loop of the catheter and place a sterile gauze piece over it with a sterile transparent dressing covering it. Place the epidural catheter over a strip of 1 inch of micropore tape on the back to avoid the catheter from embedding or leaving a pressure mark on the skin. Place a 3 inch micropore tape over the catheter to keep it in place. A good padded dressing in the back keeps the patient comfortable. Keep the proximal assembly in the sterile pouch and use a dedicated sterile syringe for top-ups of local anesthetic or a continuous infusion of local anesthetic through either a syringe pump or an elastomeric balloon pump. Thank you.